Good afternoon and welcome, everyone. My name is Ross Virginia. I'm a member of the Environmental Studies Program faculty, but I also direct the Institute of Arctic Studies here at Dartmouth, which is part of the Dickey Center for International Understanding. And thank you very much for being here with us this afternoon. I think one of the most challenging parts of being a scientist today studying climate change is finding ways to present your work in ways that really engage the public and inform the public and help shape and inform policy about climate change. You know, the creative arts and the art world has long looked to nature and to scientists for inspiration for their work and even for some of the materials that they use in creating and producing this work. And as climate change is accelerating, as we understand the profound effects of the changing planet on every aspect of our lives, both artists and scientists are seeking ways to come together to better share our work, inform our work, improve our work, but also to make this work available to the public in ways that's interesting to them and informs the way they think and view the world. The Institute of Arctic Studies has engaged a number of talks and had visitors here that really help us as scientists in particular understand this relationship. I'm thinking of people like Paul Miller, DJ Spooky, Gretel Ehrlich, Terry Tempest Williams, and even one of our own graduate students, Ruth Heindel, who's one of my students, whose field notebook is really a work of art, and as she communicates science through her sketches when she's in the field. So all these things are very important, and we look really excited to have someone here today that comes from that tradition and will share perspectives on science and art as a creative artist. And that person is Justin Brice Guariglia. Justin is a sort of multidisciplinary photographer artist, and he's most recently been working on ice and melt in Greenland and what that means for understanding climate change in the world. His work broadly explores the intersections, I would say, between ecology. I think he's sort of an ecologist at heart, but he's doing this really through the lens of politics, science, journalism, mythology, and art history. So it's a highly interdisciplinary space that he's trying to navigate through. He grew up next to the home of Hudson River School painter Asher Duran, and he studied Italian art history under the late art historian Tassirio Pignati in Venice before moving to Beijing, China in 1996, where he studied Chinese language, culture, and art. In 1997, he returned to the U.S. He finished his undergraduate degree at Wake Forest University. I also heard that he actually visited Dartmouth at that time as well. Before returning to Asia, where he's lived for 20 years, first as a student, then as a foreign correspondent, and then as a documentary photographer. From 2000 to 2008, Justin was a member of the photojournalism agency Contact Press Images. He regularly traveled widely across Asia, reporting for publications such as the New York Times, Smithsonian, National Geographic Time, Far Eastern Economic Review, and Maclean's. So you see that he's approaching all of this from as a writer, as a photographer, as a creative artist, but always, I think, interested in telling a story to the public and keeping science as part of that. In 2015, Justin began collaborating with NASA as an artist, and he got to fly with them on a number of missions doing remote sensing, looking at the rapidly changing landscape of the Greenland ice sheet. And in that process, helping scientists better describe how the ice sheet is changing. He's moving ahead. He'll be flying with a very large, complex international effort called Oceans Melting Greenland. This is a NASA mission that will run until 2020. And he is privileged to be the first embedded artist with this NASA expedition. It's a mission. It's a very high honor and a very important mission of his own that he's going to be on. He's working very hard right now to pull together some of the major pieces that are coming from this project in Greenland. There'll be a number of exhibitions. I know we talked about at lunch. Upcoming soon will be an exhibit at the Norton Museum of Art in West Palm Beach, Florida, which is an important place for the art world right now in politics, and also at USC and a number of other places moving on forward from that. So Justin's going to be talking to us about the Anthropocene, and I'll let him define what that is and how an artist sees this new age of an epic and era of Earth history. So, Justin, it's great to have you here. Welcome to Dartmouth, and a warm round of applause for us.
Hey, thanks, Russ. Thank you. I'm really thrilled to be here. This has been a long process to get to this point. I've been working on these projects for many years, and I just feel honored to be here and be able to present this work to you guys. This is the first time I'm really presenting this work to the public, and I go from here back to New York, where we're going to be opening a show on the 28th of February in Chelsea, which is going to be focused on land ice and sea ice. So this is really the first, this is the debut kind of presentation of the work. As an artist, I'm essentially focused on exploring new ways to see the world that we inhabit, that's all around us. And my work is really responding to the disconnect between humans and nature. And when I say nature, I mean the very queer sense of nature, in that we are nature. Nature is not something below us. It's not something outside of us. We are actually very integrated in this very complex web. We're enmeshed in it. We're entangled in it. And it's not something beyond us. Actually, can we turn the lights down? Thank you. As a species, we feel untouched by big global issues such as climate change. And one of the things good art can do is it can connect your mind and body and senses, allowing you to feel these things and hopefully becoming a visceral experience. And this is important today as we enter this kind of age of the hyper-object. It's an age where we as humans start to come into contact with non-human beings, such as an ice sheet. Hyperobjects are things that defy spatial and temporal scales that humans can relate to. These inherent qualities of hyperobjects, one of the inherent qualities of hyperobjects is scale confusion. When you plug your phone in to charge it or start the engine of your car, you are uncannily a part of the accretion of actions of billions of people with wide-ranging impacts on things you will never know, including things that are half a world away, such as ice sheets. So this video installation is actually going to debut in New York in a couple weeks from now. It's actually three channels, and you walk into a space, and on each wall, it's the same. The video runs about 20 minutes long, and this is the actual, this is the rough cut. We just did this the day before I left to come up here, and it's going to be projected onto three walls, and you walk into the space, and each one is set at a different place. So there's always a calving, a small calving incident happening in reverse. It's hard to experience something like global warming or climate change in the actual phenomena in and of itself, unless you are an Inuit or a winemaker, a farmer, or a NASA scientist. It's hard to see species loss. It's impossible to smell rising levels of CO2. The uncanny thing about the Anthropocene is that its vastness and complexity exceeds our way of experiencing and comprehending. It marks the end of the world as life world. This footage is taken from NASA's Operation Ice Bridge from this past spring of 2016. So to explore and better understand these changes, I actually called NASA headquarters in Washington, D.C., and I asked them if I could join Operation Ice Bridge. And this was back in 2015. And there's a kind of a funny story, backstory behind it, where they essentially said, yes, you can come and join us, but we don't have space for you, maybe for another couple years, because the planes are quite small and we don't really have space to bring in extra passengers. So being a photojournalist, my background, I actually said, well, listen, what if I got there tomorrow or in a couple days? Could you get me on the current flights? And they were saying, well, actually, we have space if you can get there, but let me just clear it. And so they cleared it with the guys back in Greenland, and they said they gave the okay. And I hustled off to the airport immediately and flew to Greenland and landed. And within a day, I was up flying with the team. Ice Bridge is essentially the largest airborne survey of Earth's polar ice that's ever been flown. Ice Bridge is essentially a patch for the ICESat 1 satellite that has gone down. And the mission is used to collect critical data used to predict the response of Earth's polar ice to climate change and resulting sea level rise. This is a view from 2015 of looking into the cockpit. You can see some of the computers here that they're running, the software that's powering the equipment. This is actually flying over the ice sheets, so we're in Greenland here. And this is glacial melange. This is after the glacier is capped off, the glacier's in the background, and pushing out towards the ocean where it's going to eventually melt. So inside these planes, this is a little, giving you a little bit of backstory, and you could see inside the plane, they're flying laser altimeters, they're flying radar, gravimeters, magnetometers, and digital mapping equipment. So it's a very, very sophisticated group of equipment that flies on these flights, and usually with quite a few scientists based on how much space they have actually in the plane. This is actually in the inside of a C-130. So one of the experiences I had was last spring in 2016, there was a phenomena called Omega Block, which occurred in April. And the Omega Block is essentially an atmospheric traffic jam, and it forms the Greek letter Omega, as you can see here, pushing all this hot air up over the Greenland's ice sheet. And this occurred 3 weeks earlier than it had ever been previously recorded. And I just happened to be out on the mission with NASA a few weeks after it had happened. So what defines this early melt event was that 12% of the ice sheet had melted by April 11th, 2016. The omega block phenomena is believed to be caused by feedback loops from global warming. Since 2002, Greenland's ice sheet has lost over 3,000 gigatons of ice mass. So I joined the mission essentially to collect hard-to-access visual information and to learn from the scientists. And I called this project, this particular project here, Field Notes Omega Block 1. And it's a collection of documentary images that form part of my art practice. And they inform me as an artist, and they inform my work. Here you can see the dust that's collected out on the ice sheets, which changed the albedo factor of the ice. I'm just going to walk you through. These are the images that are actually upstairs in the lobby. And so these images become evidence of this early melt event. But we all know technology has rapidly changed visual communication, and social media has essentially been drowning us in imagery. And as a result, we've seen the evisceration of photography and the power of the medium just through sheer ubiquity of photographs. So, I mean, how many more images of icebergs or glaciers do you need to know or see to know that they exist or that they're changing? And at what point do they stop engaging with us, these images? And photography has traditionally been about an image on paper. And these are mostly organic materials, paper being made from trees and natural breaks down and falls apart very quickly. And even as an object, they don't function very well over long periods of time. Even the work of major artists that embed their paper images in plexi cannot survive the test of time. So I began to rethink how an image is made or could be remade. At the same time, I reached out to these guys. This is the Anthropocene Working Group. Right in the center is Jan Zalasevich, and off to, on his left side, the gentleman with the glasses is Colin Waters. Jan is the head of the group and Colin is the secretary. And these are the monks of the fossil record. They're studying the Earth strata to understand our impact on the planet. And they've identified multiple human signatures, or what they call technofossils, that are coming to define our age. With this information, they're showing that we have left the comfort of the 11,700-year-old Holocene, and that we are potentially, or have already, entered a new geological epoch, the Anthropocene. One of the materials is aluminium, one of these signature materials. Elemental aluminium, which was almost unknown in its native form before the 19th century, has seen 98% of its cumulative global production of 500 million metric tons since 1950. Here's another signature material, concrete. The past 20 years has accounted for more than half of the 500 billion metric tons of concrete ever produced. The manufacture of new organic polymers, or plastics, which were initially developed in the 1900s, rapidly grew from the 1950s to an annual production of about 300 million metric tons in 2013, comparable to the present human biomass. So I started to really think about how to work these materials that define our time into my work, in regards to how they can inform my work both through materials and through process, which essentially led to this box arriving on my front doorstep. This is what was inside the box. This came from Switzerland and is a UV printer. UV printing is essentially a technology that allowed me to polymerize acrylic monomers digitally. The monomers are polymerized by UV light and essentially fossilized onto the material I choose to work with, introducing an uncanny connection to my subject matter. So from an Operation Ice Bridge trip, image of the sea ice breaking apart, are printed on a panel made from aluminum with a carbon black gesso painted on the surface. And I programmed the printer to lay the acrylic down in 100 plus layers. And that's the surface. The work becomes a proxy for the accretion of our actions on the planet, which is fundamentally changing the density of sea ice, a hyperobject in and of itself, and mirrored in the accretion of the acrylic, which is a document as a photograph, yet abstracted, and itself a hyperobject that will last nearly forever, as it's a polymer, which does not biodegrade. It is itself a technofossil, and the work effectively enters itself into the fossil record upon production. It becomes this weird, loopy, Mobius thing with no beginning and no end and no orientation. So I decided to trademark the process to protect it creatively. I call it plasticine printing, or the plasticine print. And I came up with this name because plasticine is one of the nicknames for the Anthropocene, based on how much plastic has gone into the fossil record. In another series, looking at the changes of glacial ice, working with polystyrene, I printed a glacial melange. So this is from the Jakobshavn Glacier. This is also from flying with Operation Ice Bridge and looking down from the plane. And the Jakobshavn Glacier is considered a galloping glacier. It's dumping 38 billion tons of ice into the ocean every year, and it's accelerating. Greenland's ice is around 110,000 years old at its deepest point, or the thickest part of the ice. The material, of course, has 110,000 plus year longevity. Polystyrene, made from dinosaurs, doesn't biodegrade. It lasts forever, along with the print on the surface, which is a polymerized acrylic. And here we are installing the panels in my studio. This is a close-up shot of the actual work, and you can see it's a trompe-l'oeil effect. It's just four layers of acrylic that are about a micron or so thick, but inhabits the realm of perception confusion and gets you thinking and engaged. Scale confusion is another inherent problem with understanding the Anthropocene and climate change, and another thing that I tend to play with my work. Perceiving the sublime then begins to imply a clash of scales, the small scale of human comprehension and the immense scale of the sublime object. We'll be right back. Thank you. So I guess now this is when I tear off my jacket and show you my tattoo. But I think we should probably open it up to some questions now. As you can see, this is pretty thick and heavy stuff with lots of layers. And So, Ross, do you have any questions?
Oh, a gazillion, actually. I guess one of the things that struck me early on is that we're looking at the...
One of the things that struck me early on when we were looking at the face of that was the Russo Glacier near Kangerlussuaq, Greenland. And a lot of Dartmouth people have worked there and spent time sitting in that very spot, you know, sort of watching the ice. And I was sort of getting back into that, the sort of moments of just looking and looking and contemplating and thinking that something's going to happen and it's not happening. And then abruptly something does happen, right? And it might be small and it might be really large and dramatic, and you've had the opportunity to kind of see that, which I think got me connecting back into the issues of scale that you've been struggling with, right, and the format of your work and capturing something that's very large and complex in a small photograph to this large panel installation work that you do. So how do you think about that, or how do you actually do that? What's the reaction of people that come in to see your large objects in your work? Have you talked to them? Are they seeing what you're seeing? And how? What's that process about for you?
Yeah, well, the scale is, for me, is I want people to feel like they've entered into a movie theater where they are just kind of one with the work. And I want to change the interaction that you would typically have with an image. Most images and most photographs are usually quite small, or you're seeing them on a screen today. So part of the reason I work in these large scales is to really change that conversation and change the experience. I'm trying to create emotive experiences. I'm trying to create and imbue the work with an emotive component, because I want people to actually feel what they're seeing and to actually have an experience with it. And so one of the ways I do that is through the scale. Another interesting aspect of something like climate change, or most concepts of the Anthropocene, is this kind of scale confusion, where we're talking about things that are operating on scales that we just can't relate to. And so that also works quite well with the scales that I'm working on.
Yeah, I'd not really thought about or. Scale confusion was not a pair of words that I'd thought about, but actually it's really perfect for describing some of the science that I project in my class. So one of the things I've already taken away is to think about what that means and what's embedded in those two words for thinking about these complex problems that we face. Mm. Questions, comments?
What about time? We've seen many images of the calving of the glaciers in Greenland, and I haven't seen movies run backwards before. So we see the ice going back to where it was, to its original contest. Do you do that to reinforce, to get our attention so that we pay attention again, or do you do it to show the context of what it used to be and what it is now?
Kind of dreaming of physics, right? And how we wish the glaciers were moving, right? In this day and age where they're all collapsing. You know, it's nice to actually start to think and imagine them going in the other direction and defying what is actually happening, you know, moving away from reality. So it's more about this abstraction of reality.
Thank you, Justin, for sharing these really beautiful images. And since I've not seen any of them in person, I have a question about the depth of them, because they look very dimensional. So I just wondered whether they are, or whether that's the illusion you were talking about.
Yeah.
And then the question that I had also was, so as I understand it, you're making pieces that are non-biodegradable. Mm. And I wondered how you, if you could talk a little bit about that.
Sure.
In the context of the concern about mankind, or humankind, sorry, creating non-biodegradable stuff, like
yeah.
in the Pacific Gyre and things like that. Mm.
So some of the works are optically very dimensional, and some of the works are actually physically very dimensional. And again, they're all kind of playing with your perceptions. And I do that intentionally because I'm trying to engage the mind and engage you as a viewer with the work. The actual issue with non-biodegradable materials is that, of course, it plays right into the theme of the Anthropocene, is that we are generating so many materials which have these lifespans that go beyond anything that we can relate to. I mean, this plastic bottle, if it's not recycled, will be around much longer than we will be. And it operates on a different time scale. So the way I justify it with my work is that my work is designed to be, they're designed to be documents that are evidence and proof of what had existed. And they're designed to be proof and evidence for a future time. So they're really for the future, from the future, looking back into the past. And that's one of the reasons I actually use these materials. So I want them to be around. I want them to have this lifespan. Now, the good news is if you are really into recycling and moderating our impact on the planet, you can actually recycle all these materials if you wanted to break them down. So it's fully recyclable, but if you just leave it alone, it will actually last pretty much forever. So, and that's something that's not really in the art world today. It doesn't really exist. Most works of art, especially from an archival standpoint, seem to fall apart and deteriorate pretty quickly. So this is kind of in a response to that as well.
Well, it's also an interesting play on photography, which has struggled from the beginning to be permanent, which it never could be. It was
That's
always
right.
fugitive. So
That's right.
I think there's an interesting play there.
Yeah. It's really a direct response also to the fact that we live in a very disposable society. We live in a society where things are produced and to be consumed and disposed of rather quickly. So I intentionally wanted to create something that would be lasting. Any other questions? Yes.
You had two images. Well, first you talked about this weather event that was more dramatic than usual, and it looked like there was a significant part of the ice sheet that had melted in just a very short period of time. Mm. Did I see that correctly, or?
Yeah.
So that was only in a period of months, wasn't it? They were both 2016, I believe.
It was actually weeks. It happened over the course of a few weeks.
You know?
Well, yeah. One of my grad students and I wrote a paper, not on that year, but on 2012.
Yeah.
And the people who read the paper had the same wrong impression. That, you know, we showed the vast extent of the melt over the Greenland ice sheet. Mm. The melt was only an inch or two thick.
Yeah.
But people who read the paper thought that the ice sheet had disappeared.
Okay.
So the ice didn't disappear, but the surface of it melted some.
I see.
Yeah, and that's, it got us into a lot of trouble, actually.
Thank you for explaining.
You're used to that, Mary.
Yeah, and I'm not a meteorologist, I tag on with the scientists because I'm just trying to inform my artwork. I'm trying to inform myself as a person, and that's why I engage with them and team up with the scientists. So I don't profess to be an expert in any of these things. I do profess to be a witness to what's happening. And that's part of the role of kind of a documentarian, is that you're witnessing something, and I'm actually recording. I'm trying to record these things in my own way. But I'm also, with the field notes, it's actually a direct, they become documents. With the rest of the work, though, they kind of move outside of that space, and they start to move into a space where you can interact with them, and they interact with you, and it's just, it's a whole other experience. And this is something that you don't really find in photography, in traditional photography, especially documentary photography and journalism. There is no interaction. There's usually, in fact, when things are left to be rather vague, they are negated. They're almost pushed out of the medium, and people say, "Oh, that's not no longer a document. That's no longer valid." I remember when I first presented, I was asked to come down to the Smithsonian Museum in the Museum of Natural History, and I got to meet with Scott Wing, who's a paleobotanist there and one of the chief curators. And I showed Scott the pictures of a different series of body of work, and Scott looked at them and he said, "These are so abstract, I can't show these in the museum." I said, "Well, this is what I saw, and this is what was actually there." He said, "But they don't help really tell the truth about what people are seeing or experiencing. People can't connect with them in a way that has the clarity. They don't have the clarity that we need as documents." And so actually I felt quite good about that, because I was trying to transcend the document and move it into a space where it had some, it started resonating and working on other levels. And that's what all my work is really about, is trying to build up multiple levels of engagement. So it's engaging not only your mind, but it's engaging you on a very visceral level, and hopefully moving you and connecting you to your senses. And suddenly, you know, then that's where art starts to become very powerful. But I'm doing it with a document. I'm doing it with information. And so I'm in this kind of very strange space where the work is between photography and printmaking and painting and sculpture, and people don't quite know where to place it or what it actually means, which is, I think, is so far is a strength. We'll see. The jury's still out, I guess. We have a couple hundred more years to see.
There's one back there and one over here.
Thank you so much. I have to admit I missed the beginning of your presentation, so forgive me if this question's already been answered, but who or what informs the work that you do, and what do you take most inspiration from within the visual arts in the work that you've done here?
So the question, who do I take inspiration from?
Yeah, what work has inspired your own?
Yeah. Oh, artwork.
Yeah.
Oh. Okay, your first question was?
Yeah, bodies of work or
yeah.
Just,
wow.
Yeah, cosmically, what inspires?
Yeah.
I mean, I hate to, that's a loaded question, but.
It is quite a loaded question. I have a very diverse kind of background as an artist, because I never had a formal training as an artist. I never went to art school. I never went and studied journalism either. I'm not a scientist, and I really come from a background that's it's liberal arts, essentially. So over the years, most of what has inspired me are my experiences that I've had actually out in the field, whether I was working for the Smithsonian or the New York Times. And there's a pretty wide range of things. When the SARS epidemic happened, I was the lead photographer for that project for the New York Times. So I was the one who was sent out into the field to trace the virus all the way back to the small village in China, in Guangdong, where it came from. And everything from, and when you look at something like this, you look at a virus that spreads around the world very rapidly, you start to understand the complexity of civilization and kind of evolution and how everything is changing so rapidly. And also as a student and living in China and traveling around Asia during this period, which I call the Great Asian Acceleration. So the Great Acceleration is essentially the last, like, I guess about 60 years or so. The Great Asian Acceleration really was about 25, almost 30 years, where China started to pull all the countries in Asia up out of poverty. And as you were there traveling around and experiencing the different cultures, you were seeing how they were transforming before your eyes. And a lot of these things, and again, this is not art, but it is in a way. I mean, these things were transforming so quickly that you couldn't help but notice the impact that they had, in, you know, right in front of you. So that's what's inspired a lot of this work. In terms of actual art, I mean, my inspiration comes from all over the board. I mean, everything from, you know, all the humanities essentially impact. I couldn't name a single artist or artwork. It's just, it comes from all over the place. So, yeah.
Thank you for being here. I just had a question about, wow, it just escaped me, but I'll ask a different question. The time-lapse videos that you made of the glacier calving, I thought those were really interesting. I was curious about whether those reflect the actual scale of how quickly the glaciers were calving or whether it was sped up.
Yeah, so those are actually in real time. Those are all in real time. And when you reverse them, it just seems to change everything because your mind, you know, we're not used to experiencing these things in reverse. So it becomes this whole other experience that you have when you view it. So they seem to be quite absurd, right? I mean, but they're all in real time.
Hi. I'm wondering about if your work is intended to change people's behavior and move them to recycle more or make policy changes or whatever they might do in regards to climate change. And then I'm also wondering how you deal with the sense of, like, impending doom that's always surrounding climate change and that really turns people off. I think your reverse one sort of mitigated that in a way that brought up the topic but didn't seem like a sense of impending doom. So just curious of what you think about that.
Yeah, the impending doom. The impending doom of climate change. Do you think you're going to experience the impending doom of climate change?
Probably. I don't know. I think my children might.
Yeah. Yeah, it's on a time scale that we're just not all that quite connected to, right? Because I think if we really felt it impending, we would probably be responding to it a little bit differently. You know, again, I think if you're making artwork that is addressing these ideas, your hope is that it will be effective, and your hope is that it will move somebody. How it moves them, you know, we have to see, and that's not quite my role is. In working with these materials and these ideas and concepts is really I want to get people engaged and thinking about these things because they are kind of beyond us in so many ways, right? We're just not, how many people, I mean, this is the wrong crowd to ask how many people have been to Greenland or been on an ice sheet because they're probably half the room has. But typically most people who would be experiencing or seeing the work will never have the opportunity to go and stand in front of the glacier and or be on an ice sheet or have any idea what an ice sheet is or how fast it's moving or the fact that it's calving off. And so I think that it's important to address these things and get people thinking about them. And my hope is that it moves somebody enough, they feel something strong enough that it gets them to possibly rethink whatever it is that they may have thought and believed. So that's my hope with the work. I'm trying to move people. So. Yes.
Thanks, Russ. Thank you. I guess a few
entangled questions. Mm-hmm. I'm curious what you found.
It's all entangled.
Right? Yeah, it's all entangled. What you may have found going out to Greenland and into the field that you didn't expect to find there, or what really surprised you, and how did that translate into work that you were not anticipating that you might make? And then perhaps entangled with that question is just, how do you then see this project through 2020 or in the future changing and evolving based upon what you discovered?
Yeah. Wow. Whew. You know, when you first get out near an ice sheet, you know, you don't understand what it is that you're next to. You feel it, you smell it, you hear it, you see it, but you don't quite comprehend it. And that's one of the magical things about these places, is that they kind of continue on forever. And they're very difficult to orientate either yourself around it or orientate the actual concept of or idea of what it is that you're interacting with. And so when you're out there and with these things, it's just, for me, as a layperson, somebody who's not a scientist, doesn't quite understand fully, not nearly as much as a lot of the scientists in here in this room do, it becomes this overwhelming thing. It's this very humbling experience that you have. What came out of it that I did not expect, I'd say, is I didn't expect anything. I had no expectations because I didn't know what I was getting myself into, actually, when I first went out there. So it was all unexpected. And then the response was it was very intuitive. It was a very intuitive response. We just had to record and accumulate as much information, much visual information as possible to then play with later. Because there are all these interconnections, and it is a very, very complex web that we've woven as a civilization. And our impacts here today, where I just have this computer plugged in and this generating heat, is impacting the glaciers that are in Greenland or in Antarctica. And we're just so removed from all these things. And that became when you started to realize the fact that, you know, we are in this room and we are in contact with the air that is here, and it's the same air that is in contact with the glaciers over there, and which is melting the ice. And all these, it's a very, very intricate web that we are just so far removed from. Once you start to realize these things, these interconnections, I think it starts to become almost debilitating because it's so overwhelming. In terms of 2020, going through, this is actually a new mission that I'm embedded in, and I actually haven't started flying with the OMG team. So OMG is Oceans Melting Greenland. It's a mission that's run out of JPL, the Jet Propulsion Lab at NASA's facility with Caltech out in Pasadena. And the PI on this mission, the principal investigator, is Josh Willis, who's an oceanographer. And Josh is essentially sending probes down into the water. He has a G3 that's outfitted where they ran a missile launcher into the back of this G3 airplane. And they're sending probes out of the back of the plane. And these probes hit the water after late in the season when the waters around Greenland are fairly ice-free. And as they descend down to the bottom of the ocean, they are measuring the salinity, they're measuring the temperature, and they're measuring the depth. So they're coming back with all this information, the bathymetry information, and they're sending it all back wirelessly back to the plane that's flying up above the ice sheet. And so Josh is recording these things and trying to come up with all the data points and understand better how the oceans are interacting and melting the ice sheets. So this is really, just for me, it's a fascinating subject. What they're trying to do is understand how much time we have until the ice sheets melt, and you know, what essentially is going to happen with sea level rise. So again, for me, it's I'm just a spectator and get to go on the flights and get to talk with the scientists and get to get on the ground with them and absorb and try to gather up as much information as I can as an outsider that's embedded in the mission and use that material to try to create things as an artist. So this is all new, and I'm due to fly my first mission with OMG this coming in fall of 2017. So that's yet to be seen, but yeah.
Justin, I have a question, maybe a comment even.
Yeah.
I really like the way you talked about art as document. Mm. What inspired you to use your body as document, your tattoo of the temperature record? How did you become engaged in that thought and then follow through with that? And what is the reaction that people, when you interact with people?
My parents?
Well, whoever. I mean, it's very powerful in the way you're presenting this. But what sort of led to that, and how has that been working as part of your art? Because I think it is. Your body's now document, right? Mm.
Yeah. Wow. Well, you know, this the tattoo was something that I had wanted for quite a while, but I didn't quite know what I wanted to do and how I wanted to do it and what it represented and what it meant. And I just started moving deeper and deeper into this body of work. And I kind of stepped back. I mean, for me, this work is not really about climate change. My work is not about the climate so much as it's really about the Anthropocene. It's about something that's much more meta, because I feel like if you go too deep into one area or one concept, you start to limit yourself as an artist, and you need to stay as broad-based as possible. And I was in touch with Colin Waters, who's also an artist, the secretary of the Anthropocene Working Group. And Colin and I have been in touch, sending emails back and forth for quite a while. And I knew that this geological congress was meeting in South Africa, and I knew that he had told me already what was going to be announced. And I said, you know, this is a really great peg and a really good reason to do this, to actually move forward with something that was symbolic of this geological epoch that we are now, that they're kind of ratifying as a term. And I figured, what better way than to take carbon and just implant it under my arm permanently as kind of a signifier of where we are today. And of course, with the, I also contacted Jim Hansen at NASA, and who was quite amused. Jim Hansen was the fellow who came up with this index back in the 1970s when he realized that nobody was really paying attention to global surface temperature. So he started pulling this index together. And also to Gavin Schmidt. So Gavin Schmidt is the current director of NASA's GIS at Columbia University, the Goddard Institute of Space Sciences. And Gavin wrote me back, he wrote me an email back, and he said, you know, this is one of the most bizarre requests I've ever gotten, because I wanted to make sure that the index was correct before I put it on, because I didn't want to have the wrong index on there, and they keep changing the index and stuff. And he wrote me back, and he said, listen, I got to tell you, though, we came out with a new index. And I was like, shit. And this is a couple days before I'm going to get the tattoo put on, and we'd already tested it and everything to make sure and placed it. And he said, he sent it to me. He said, look, this is the new one. And we figured out how to remove some of the noise in the data. And it looked like this beautiful kind of, now it had these like kind of this beautiful wave pattern. And I don't want that. I'm going to stick with the old one. So I wanted the sharper lines and the edges and stuff, because it was more significant to kind of how I felt about this whole thing. So yeah, that's kind of where the tattoo came from. It was just, yeah. It was really about supposed to be something also fun and in a way. It's serious, but it's also,
Well, if you're interested in the photographs that Justin took on Ice Bridge, which inform and inspire his art, we have a sampling of those photographs up in the Russo Gallery right upstairs here. And tomorrow at 4:30, correct? Justin will be there to talk a little bit more about the relationship between those photographs and his art, and also just to interact with you more personally. So you're all welcome to join that. There'll be a group of Dartmouth students also engaged in that gallery talk. So that's 4:30 tomorrow upstairs, right above us in the Russo Gallery. And this has been terrific, and I want to thank you very much for being here and sharing your time with us. And you'll be meeting with students tomorrow and over at Studio Art and graduate students that are interested in this art-science collaboration, this imagination that we can generate to inform the public around climate and around the Anthropocene. So thank you very much, and we really enjoyed your time. Thank you.
Thank you very much.